Once again, we've come to a very, very exciting, a very, very enlightening panel discussion. Ladies and gentlemen, it's about bringing about a digital transformation in the mutual fund industry. Well, India's digital revolution has transformed the entire economic structure of the country. Digitalization has penetrated in every industry and market, transforming the way industries operate, and the mutual fund market is no different. With the demonetization effect, rapid digitization, government incentives, regulatory initiatives, and a deliberate push for improving investor education, the industry has seen a rising growth since 2016. It created a wave in the country to go cashless, and that's how it impacted the mutual fund industry to go paperless. So let's hear it, ladies and gentlemen, from the expert panelists on how we can bring about a digital transformation in the mutual fund industry. May I call upon the stage Mr. Anuj Kumar, CEO, CAMS, Mr. V. Ganesh, CEO, Carvey, Mr. Ramesh V., CEO, Mutual Fund Utility, and Mr. Nirav Kaushik, Vice President, Asia Pacific, Franklin Templeton Services, India. And the panel will be moderated by Mr. Mayank Jha, Principal Consultant at the Boston Consulting Group. Let us have a huge round of applause, ladies and gentlemen, for all our panelists and our moderator, of course. And with that, I hand it over to you, Mr. Mayank. Thank you.
Hello. Good afternoon, everyone. The first session after lunch is always a tricky one. We have to make sure that this is interesting for all of you. But there's an esteemed set of panelists that we have on a very pertinent topic in the industry. This digital transformation is affecting all our lives. Whether it is shopping, whether it is banking, whether it is travel, lifestyle. All aspects are being covered, and there are tectonic shifts happening in the mutual fund industry as well. Just to put in context, we took 50 years to get to our first 10 lakh crore AUM as the industry. From moving from 10 lakh to 20 lakh crore, it just took 3 years. So that's the pace at which the industry is growing. Now, other than the numbers in the last 3 years, what has also fundamentally shifted is the extent of digital in the industry. The digital direct sales business is growing exponentially over 100% CAGR. Most of the customers, if you look at direct digital direct channels, they are transacting online. 63% of the transactions in retail segment are happening on online channels. This is the direct channel. The second impact that is happening is the onboarding time is shrinking. Opening SIPs 4 or 5 years back would take a 20-25 day period. Today it has been crunched down to a 2 day period or even lesser by many distributors and manufacturers. The costs are coming down. Digital is significantly impacting the costs. And what the set of panelists that we have here are at the forefront of making this process efficiency work in the digital space. So let me start the discussion with Ganesh. You've seen the industry very closely on the financial services side. So what are your perspectives on the advent of digital in the financial services space, and how does it, how do you see it changing our industry?
Yeah, thanks for asking that. Thanks to AMFI for setting up this forum. It's going to be a little difficult to keep you awake on a boring topic like service. Normally, service gets very interesting when you screw it up, but not otherwise. Otherwise, it's treated as BAU, and you would want to run service as BAU all across all the time. I wanted to demystify some of the myths around what is digital. And I want to talk about this in the context of the BFSI industry. Let's take the banking sector, which is by far the largest. Today, the banking sector has about 157 crore accounts. And out of that, there's only 5 crore which has mobile and internet banking. What that means is that and to give you another data point, the banking sector has last year reported something like 150 crore digital transactions. Now, we need to understand what this digital is. If you leave that 5 crore aside, which have mobile and or internet banking, we are talking about the rest of that 150 crore transactions being put through a lot of physical but so-called digital channel. For example, when you want to do an RTGS, you would still want to have to drop a form at the bank. When you want to do an NEFT, you still have to drop a form at the bank. When you want to do an ATM withdrawal, which is so-called digital, what you have given up is just the front-end piece of a physical human teller. You still need a card, you still need to go swipe, put in your details as much as you would cut a check, and then you will withdraw that money. You want to go to credit cards and debit cards that you use, you need a point of sale terminal. So there is a physical device and there is a physical engagement that always exists in the industry unless you are truly digital. Now I'll come to that, what I mean by digital. Let me take the example of the mutual fund industry. Today there are many ways, but I'll just bifurcate that as physical and digital, although in my view it's a misnomer. A physical is what? A physical is where an investor comes to your Kanpur branch, drops in a form, and expects the transaction to be processed. Believe me, only that input is where instead of the investor kind of inputting it directly on the system, we input it as transfer agents, and the rest of the process is fully digital. The customer gets his email on an automated manner. The transactions after the NAV comes get automated and processed in an automated manner. The emails that go as customer statement of account is completely on a scheduler. The SMSs that go is completely electronic. You want to take a redemption, that's completely electronic. In fact, on the redemption side, we are like at 99% plus electronic. You want to take a dividend, that is also electronic. So I somehow feel that digital is being confused with self-service. If self-service is digital, which means that you are entering your transaction on the mobile or you're giving it to the stock exchange or MFU, et cetera, then digital has its meaning. But honestly, the way we are running the processes today in the marketplace, and I say this on behalf of all of us here, is actually fully digital. There's nothing that happens manually. There's no physical intervention that happens. And there's just that one piece of data capture that actually happens in the front end on behalf of the investor. And believe me, even that the investor does not do. The investor actually signs the dotted line because the distributor helps him fill up the form. So we need to just understand whether what we are calling is truly digital is digital or not. Another classic example I will take, and then you can go on, is this whole piece of Amazon being digital, Swiggy being digital, Book My Show being digital, IRCTC being digital. If one were to think through, if you take IRCTC, for example, or Book My Show, to me, it looks like very close to being digital. You know why? Because you're able to book your ticket at a time of your choice, at a movie hall of your choice, for a movie of your choice, and a seat of your choice. And then what comes back to you is an electronic confirmation with a QR code. Then you go to the movie theater or you go to the train, and you show your mobile, and you don't print anything output. And then the TTE, the travel ticket examiner, or the movie ticket examiner, just checks it, and that's again a physical element there which can be completely given up if entry is only allowed based on the QR code. The rest of it is all electronic. The payment is electronic, the reconciliations are electronic, the settlement across different banks that Book My Show would do is electronic. But imagine Swiggy, imagine Amazon. I mean, when I say Amazon, I'm talking about Amazon online buying. There's a whole lot of downstream activities that one has to do. So you only place, do the self-assistance, which means you say, I want so many pieces of idlis or dosas or rotis or whatever, and that's it. Then there is a huge team which gets into play. And most of the time what happens? The situation is even worse because most of the time it's cash on delivery. So the customer, the Swiggy guy comes to your home, delivers whatever it is, you give a cash, he has to reconcile the cash at the back end, make sure that the money, there is no pilferage of money, and so on. So the point I'm making is people, in my view, my sense is that sometimes digital is getting a little more overrated than where it is at this point in time. In terms of numbers, penetration, so assuming for a minute that putting through a transaction on the stock exchange or MFU or mobile or website, let's say that we call that as truly digital, that number today in the industry is far higher than the bank. If you take the banking industry today, as I said, it's about 150 crore of transaction, but only 5 crore banking users who have internet and mobile. In the industry that we represent, I think about anywhere between 20 to 40%, depending on the client and, you know, adoption of various channels available, we are at about 30%. That's one part. The other important part that I want to make a mention here is that in the whole glory of digital, people forget the physical. Today, if you see the industry growth, industry might have gone from 100 to 200 transactions over 2 years' time. And industry might have gone from 80-20 to 70-30 in terms of physical and digital. But that absolute number of physical transactions that exist in the marketplace today is significantly higher than what it used to be 2 years back. And those need to be serviced, which is why I keep saying that, you know, we should have phygital and not digital. And we heard Chairman SEBI speaking exactly the same language, that if you want financial inclusion, you want to go to tier two, tier three towns, you must establish a process where you have enhanced physical presence, and no better way than to learn from the banks. In the last 3 years, banks have added something like 24,000 branches. And some of the large private banks have added something like 300 branches every year. So we need to have a footprint which kind of covers physical and digital. And we should call digital as digital, in my view, when that whole process works like Book My Show, which to me, we are a far cry away. I'll take a pause here.
So that's a very interesting perspective. You know, there is an element of digitization of processes which the RTAs are working on, but there is a forward journey to it where does a transaction fully flow through digitally right from the manufacturer's end. Here, Nirav, can I bring you in? You know, as someone who also is a manufacturer, do you see digital impacting the end investors, and what are some of your perspectives there on how we can make this flow on digital seamless right from the manufacturer to the RTAs?
Sure, thanks Mayank, and I think I echo what obviously Ganesh just said, but there are a couple of different views. I agree that digital can be expanded as digitalization overall. And you can take either an inward-looking view that, you know, how all of us, when we service our clients, manage using digital. But I think importantly, the client view or how client can be service, engage, in my sense, and I can also give you a view of what's happening outside India, there is a lot of impact of digital. I completely agree. I think when I joined this industry about 12 years back, we used to probably process 20% of transaction we process today. And I don't think all of us as an industry have grown so much, but the transaction and the client base has definitely grown so much. And the digitalization definitely has a play in that growth. So from a manufacturer perspective, and I'm reminded, you know, I'm sure all of us have seen that movie, Three Idiots, right? When the professor asks Amir Khan, what is machine for you? And the Amir Khan says, machine is anything which reduces human effort. And vis-a-vis a very theoretic kind of definition the other guy gives. The digital, in my view, is that kind of sense. And that's what you have to keep it simple, that can that make client and distributor and manufacturer and the RTA's life easier, right? If that can be done, then you will find a lot of successes happening. The second thing, I think, and you talked about manufacturer, which works from a manufacturer perspective, in digital, you can do a power of and, not or, right? And what I mean by that is, the way client is wanting the service or engagement, they are not saying, I want best-in-class service at the highest cost, right? We can't say, okay, I can give you this personalized service, but it's gonna charge you 4% or 5% cost of that. So you have to find ways, can I give that service at the current scale of whatever scale I think Ganesh talked about, but yet personalize it. So if you can keep adding those ands, you know, scale service and personalization at customer convenience 24/7, you will find digital will probably play the most important role. Because you cannot put bodies behind all these things. I think we'll drown if you start to put bodies behind that kind of experience for the client. The other thing is, and again, it's a little bit of a different view. Digital is not so much of only exciting part, it's also about survival, right? People like us in our industry will not survive unless you deploy both outward-looking and inward-looking digital technologies from a manufacturer perspective, from an RTA perspective. Those are things I see happening in Franklin Templeton in, as a manufacturer. Let me span it out and see what's happening in the world across where, you know, obviously we have a view. There's a lot of strong automation which happens outside, right? The client experience, in my view, is probably one of the best in India, from a digital, especially from a digital perspective. And that's because the operating models have matured significantly outside than what we have in India. The markets are also different, to be fair. The retail kind of penetration which we have, you know, other markets don't see that. And in my view, that does play about what kind of offerings will you give to the clients. So if you look at China, right, which is obviously as big a country as India, you will find the level of automation is almost 100%, right? And the automation is, to Ganesh's point, is not that the clients are inputting every damn thing in the system. The automation is they have very beautifully co-opted the distribution community in this chain. And that's, in some sense, a pet peeve for me. I think in India, that relationship has to be three-dimensional. Client, distribution, and the manufacturing RTAs. It can't be two-dimensional. And whenever you take one leg out of it, you'll always find the success rates are not so good. And that's the feeling I get. In China, they probably made sure that the stock exchanges, the distributors, obviously the manufacturers, and clients have come together and gone back to the Amir Khan point of saying, how do I reduce the effort, rather than creating a very, very nice-looking proposition.
So the distributor point of view will come across in the next panel that we have today. Moving to you, Anuj, you know, when we are looking at all the improvements that are happening on the digitization of the processes at the RTA's end. And just taking this point of you know, having the manufacturers and the distributors weaved in, you know, what can we, if we fast forward 3 years, what can we expect a mutual fund transaction to look like? Could it be as simple as WhatsApp Pay today? You know, you just put a person's photo and you know, and the amount, and that goes through. So in mutual funds, can we see it moving in that direction? How would, if you fast forward 3 years, what could the transaction world look like?
That's an interesting question, Mayank. Just to give you a perspective, and I would agree in part with Ganesh that the depth of technological intervention in the world of RTAs and world of mutual fund processing is quite intense, except for two exceptions. And I think the first exception is how we set up an account. Because when we set up an account and figures are vindicated by the number of new people who come into the mutual fund industry who set them up electronically, that number is probably still in its teens. Because when you have a new person coming in wanting to set up his account, doing a KYC, and trying to put a payment in, that is a set of three asynchronous processes, mostly running on paper, because there are optimum solutions available, but they're not bundled as well as they should be. And the usage is less. Once you have people who've set up their accounts, like you said, their propensity to use digital or the distributor's propensity to use a platform goes up significantly. So that's point number one. Point number two, today the service process, if we take out setup and purchase and come to service, it's run almost as if there are four discrete entities in the entire process. There's an investor, there's a distributor, there's a manufacturer, and there is an RTA. And to that extent, I've always believed that the industry can do with a high dosage of productivity infusion. Because it's almost like the investor stops by at the distributor's place, who stops by at the AMC's place, who stops by at the RTA's place. And because it is run in this slightly splintered fashion, we can put a lot of productivity back into the system by allowing a lot of do-it-yourself, automated, first-time right delivery of services off a website, off an app, even off a call center to an extent, but taking a few steps out of this. Now, the entire industry has to align and kind of subscribe to that thought process, but that is entirely possible. Coming to your specific question, what may happen 5 years from now or 3 years from now? I can tell you, for example, the winds of change sometimes blow very fast. We have a property to accept liquid transactions on a web app, and which can be accessed on your desktop too. 2 years ago, that number was probably 1% of the liquid transactions that we process. Today, it is high teens, which means that every month we almost see transactions doubling, and the adoption rates are very high. In terms of technology, I would say a slew of technology is being used by RTAs and by AMCs in order to both enhance customer experience and make sure that we deliver things first time right as an immediate gratification to the consumer. And I give this example often. Even in the world of paper, there are no timestamp machines which directly link to a central system in the world of an RTA or an AMC, and we are using the Internet of Things to figure out how many discrete pieces of paper land up in an office of ours so that we can absolutely 100% reconcile them office by office, document class by document class, and ensure that there are no variances and no lost or unaccounted pieces of paper. So that's one example. Similarly, we will see that limited deployments of blockchain will start showing up. And I'm not thinking of an end-to-end multi-distributor kind of environment, but for a single AMC, for a set of consumers and a set of distributors, you will see that in the next two to three years, this will begin happening. And like you said, as payments become easier and more automated, and in a single instance, it is possible for us to seek an investment from a consumer as a subscription, and then move him either to a banking website or a simple single-click or double-click payment mechanism, and to an eKYC, it is possible that the entire mutual fund account setup process will be a few minutes, comprising a payment, an account setup, an Aadhaar-based validation through the through which the person e-signs for himself, and we validate him through the UIDI database details. And that kind of completely sums up the process. A lot of that is being done in different parts right now, but I think it's probably a matter of the next maybe 3-4 quarters within which you will see this process kind of coming together, converging, and getting used by a lot of individuals and distributors.
Anuj, I am just picking one point that you mentioned that's around the alignment of the industry. Now, on MF utility, that was that's an attempt to get that alignment, especially from the transaction point of view. Ramesh, I would like to ask, you know, as you take this journey, what are some of the challenges that you are facing in getting digital adopted, you know, in the latter part of the value chain?
It's very interesting. Honestly, after trying to make distributors adopt. Primarily, we are focused on distributors to adopt MFU. I am still surprised how did smartphones penetrate so much. There is no presentation for smartphones. There is no user manual for smartphones, but everybody started using it. When we talk about MFU, there are distributors, they keep asking, "Arre, kisne kuch bataya nahi, kaise karna hai? Hame pata hi nahi kya hai? I don't know, no one has really shown, no presentation was done." This is a huge challenge that I see, because the fact is that it's all user-friendly, it's a user convenience, the experience is made in such a manner that's easy to understand and adopt. The guys who are conveniently adopting to a smartphone, they are still reluctant to adopt to digitization of transactions. This is one of the biggest challenges that I saw. Secondly, in terms of information, though in MFU we are getting transaction from some very, very small towns where I have not heard at all, like Kaithal, Gonda, Gondia, some Khed, Surguja, these kind of places we get transaction from. But yet, the knowledge of MFU is not there. And therefore, people keep asking, why don't you advertise? Why don't you, you know, talk about it? Why don't you market, kind of thing? So this is another challenge where a person from Surguja is able to access and understand, but somebody from Mumbai is not really adopting it and taking it over. This is one of the challenges. Third one is in terms of the, I think when AMFI initiated, as Bala mentioned in the morning, MFU was intended to be a collaborative and not a competitive system at all. Somehow it has always been mentioned as a platform everywhere, but I always keep telling this is not a platform, this is more of a system to aggregate the transactions. So essentially, this was not really the message and positioning of MFU was a challenge. It was not really happening. And therefore, there was a lot of confusion among the people, and they always used to pitch this against other medium of transactions. So how do you come out of it is another challenge. Having said that about MFU, I think to the extent that people adoption has limitations, unless someone pokes them, they don't really adopt as much easily as possible. That is a major challenge that I see in coming. I think the GenNivesh, et cetera, which is coming in, probably today the investor awareness that's happening is all talking about products. I think once mutual fund sahi hai, somebody understands, and then what? It never says what to do subsequently. I think that is where opening a can and, you know, taking transactions, et cetera, if, along with product, if process is also being made aware to the customers and distributors and other people, I think then the adoption will be far, far faster and easier, is what my understanding is.
So there is a point about next level of education that is required, you know, both to the distributors and customers. And maybe, yeah, you know, Nirav, I'll come to you here, you know, as again, you know, bringing a manufacturer's point of view. You know, how do you see digital playing a role there? You know, one part is, you know, we invest a lot of money as an industry and keep on promoting this through other media. But digital being a low-cost and highly effective model of getting awareness through things like gamification, it is really possible. How do you see the role of digital coming there in bringing awareness?
So I think that's a good question, Mayank. I would completely agree. You cannot not have digital in the awareness and education section, because to my earlier point, if you want to have a scale, right, if you want to talk in the client language, you know, multiple languages and multiple places as a client choice, you cannot have anything else but the combination, again, maybe the distributor and digital. Those two Ds have to work. Because I think I agree with Ramesh, clients probably, if the distributors are fully sold, then the clients probably listen to the distributor more, and they are willing to engage into a digital kind of a forum from an education perspective. But other thing which you've seen, I think you touched on that, As you see the younger population entering into the mutual fund industry, the gamification kind of tools, which are utilized by many, many, many of us, will help us to make it attractive. I think the slightly different view to Ramesh, my point is that, you know, smartphones became effective because people like using them, right? It's not that the smartphones are there because somebody has to tell somebody that, okay, smartphone use. They are very intuitive. People like to use them. It's easy. Similar ways we'll have to find when we use digital for awareness. So can we use gamification? I think what, for example, what we have done and some of our people have done is usage of live stories. You know, in this industry of mutual fund, if you look at for last 25 odd years, we have lot of real stories of clients and distributors who started from there to now, you know, where they're sitting. And digital could be the medium to put those stories in front of so many clients. The word of mouth in this industry is the best marketing or education, right? If my friend tells me that, okay, this fund is good or this person is good, likelihood of me looking at that fund is much, much higher than, you know, what I see in the newspaper and those kind of things. So I would see in education, things like gamification, things like social media, again, you know, a newer way of engaging with our client base, as well as putting live stories in front of client in the language of their choice at the time they want. I think digital is the only way you can do that.
Thank you. And just shifting gears a little towards all the data that is being, you know, now collected. You know, the amount of transactions have gone up. So the volume of data that now resides with RTAs is phenomenal. My question to you, Ganesh, is how are RTAs thinking about using this data to advantage? How you know, how can we use this data, whether it is to improve customer experience, whether it is to help the manufacturers, help the distributors? What are some of the use cases of data that we are seeing, you know, as the digital transactions move forward?
Yeah, so that's a very interesting question. I think when we talk about digital, we should talk about policies, products, and services. So if we talk about policies, how the regulation is helping the digital cause, and what are the steps being taken, if you talk about products, for example, if you take Kindle or Amazon, what used to be paperback books earlier has completely gone digital through the way Amazon has completely made it fully electronic. And in terms of services is where, you know, we all represent. There are a lot of use cases, the Mayank, that already exists in the industry. Let me take some examples. When you do a KRA during the good old days, while you would have a protocol to exchange data with the service provider and the KRA licensed agency, you will internally make sure that it is seamlessly updated without any additional trouble to the investor. You won't find that in the banking industry. You won't find that in the insurance industry. When we talk about common account statement, mutual fund industry was the first, and I'm sure there are many beneficiaries here, which started off with what is called as MFCAS, which means that across the four RTAs, you could get a single statement at the click of a button, and the mail back will come to you in roughly 5 minutes or 10 minutes or so. So utilizing data and utilizing aggregation capabilities, of course, CERSAI has now come in, and that's making that process equally efficient in terms of refresh across customers and across products, and across manufacturers, whether it's mutual fund or insurance, whoever is adopting CERSAI, they're benefiting from that. But there is already that much exists. For example, the distributors in this community are perhaps very uniquely served by aggregating data of transactions across their customers, across product lines. So they get all that as download from us free of cost, and that's again a, you know, use case for aggregation that's been happening for more than a decade now. But what we are now doing is, you know, sorry to use a cliche word like big data, we are taking in a lot of efforts along with our clients to make sure that we get into other form of analytics. For example, we have launched, and I'm not trying to propagate Carvey here, but we've launched a product like Redemption Secure. What that product does is it kind of runs an algo on all the historic data and comes up and tells you what are the potential redemptions that could happen next week, next month, based on how much history you're able to go back to. Same way, there is a method by which we forecast subscriptions and then go back and share that with the particular client. This is intra-client. I'm not talking about inter-client at all. Intra-client, if there is some tenure of the client, like 5 years or 10 years or 7 years or so and so, you have enough data to kind of go back and tell the client how to predicate the future. Unfortunately, analytics, you know, has always been about trying to analyze the past, and what big data analytics now brings to the table is what is very interesting, which is about predicating the future. And we are doing a lot of work in that space. I'm sure many other RTAs are.
So this is very interesting. You know, banking industry on the other side is right now moving towards, you know, getting more early warning signals on what is going to default. So similarly in mutual fund, you're looking at what is going to redeem, and you're trying to you know, get that to action.
Absolutely.
You know, hope is also that, you know, like Amazon says, you know, this is what is recommended for you.
Right.
Maybe you're able to tell the end investors, this is the next best recommended fund for you.
No, that I can't tell. SEBI is here. So we cannot recommend a particular product, but jokes apart, that's what is the future is. So.
Yeah. Okay. The other question when it comes to data is around the security of the data. You know, cyber security and data privacy has become a very important concern, and touchy topic. And what are the, you know, how are RTAs protecting the data for our end investors? And will mutual fund always remain sahi hai, you know, from that perspective?
Right. See, cyber security is a very, very interesting topic, very serious topic. To some extent, not fully, largely undermined in India as a whole, and not specifically to mutual funds or anything like that. SEBI, of course, last year came up with a lot of cyber security related governance and issued a circular and so on. But I'll tell you some data points around cyber security, and you'll be shocked to hear this. The world spends about $3.7 trillion every year on digital. Cyber crimes is equal to $3.7 trillion as we speak today annually. 24% of cyber crimes happen in BFSI. So we are very, very susceptible to cyber crimes. World over, every 9 seconds, there's a cyber crime happening. In India, that's at about 39 seconds. So these results are extremely serious. So there's going to be a time where we will spend more on cyber crime, because the pace at which cyber crime is growing than the amount of digital spend that we would do in the marketplace. The key thing there is to see how we can kind of protect ourselves against a whole lot of cybercrime related issues. And believe me, cybercrime today is not easily insurable as well. Just to give you some idea, you can take an indemnity, professional indemnity policy on errors and omissions and pay, say, 100 rupees. The same thing for cybercrime related insurance coverage is anywhere between 5x to 8x. Because that's how cybercrime, so it's only next to terrorism, the kind of insurance that you pay to cover cybercrime. That's one part. The second part is that we keep building layers and layers of security, and more new hacks come in. For example, cybercrime does not consider what is known as DDoS. DDoS, to just give a quick benefit, is understanding for all of us, is distributed denial of service. So what they do is they do not get into your data, but if your system is capable of handling, let's say, 10,000 transactions in a second or a minute, they will be pumped with 10 million. So there's no option but for the server to hang, and that's not part of cybercrime. So there is a lot of work that we need to do to make sure that, one, education about cybercrime, two, For example, how many companies have a forensic audit department? There's hardly any that you can think of that, you know, apply forensics, which is the future, in my view, in terms of managing cybersecurity and cyber threat. So at this point in time, I would like to say that we are fairly there, but we still have a long way to go. And more importantly, we have not still become the center of attraction. So the moment we become like that, like banks, et cetera, there will be significant challenges. And I'm sure you all know what happened with Yahoo, Facebook, and so many others who are supposed to have the best of security and the data getting compromised. And then there is the other element which is coming about data privacy. We are seeing that with UIDI in India and the Supreme Court related rulings, et cetera. We are seeing that in the law that the European Union has just launched, saying that you cannot use the data of one customer for his own benefit with another transaction unless he specifically approves. To me, sometimes I feel that these are really going overboard, because ultimately you're trying to help the customer. But then the way privacy has been compromised, there is this feeling among regulators that let's go to the other extreme.
So, Anuj, a question to you. We've been hearing about all the impact of digital. Now, this will fundamentally change the RTA business, going forward with the number of digital transactions increasing. How are you thinking about RTAs in the future? How are you redefining yourself? How are you reinventing yourself?
No, sure, that's a very relevant question. And the way we are structuring and frameworking this is in three or four different ways. The first is the question of talent. Largely, the RTAs have been platform companies with a very thick layer of manually performed services. As you get more digital, you have to be talent heavyweight, more in the technology, digital, storage, those kind of arenas. And the service layer will at some point in time get thinner than what it is. So the way we structure a talent, the way we strategize around it is one of the key requirements, and that is what consumes time and energy. The second thing is that consumers are going to continue comparing us with the world of consumer internet, which means that a consumer experiences an airline or experiences a cab company. And when we bring them to our website or to our app or to an AMC app, their ability to comprehend the multiple levels of checks, the two-factor authentication, the multiple levels of security that we will build, sometimes consumers are just not prepared for it. And user experience and the interface become of paramount importance, but the do-it-yourself customer is not distinguishing us, saying you are a financial services provider and therefore you're so different to the rest of the world that I transact with that I'm going to spend 3 minutes where I normally spend a minute. And therefore, it is important for us to kind of think about the possibilities, keep multi-layered security as a requirement, but still make it easy for the consumers. Now, it's easy for me to say all this, but when we start the design process, it really becomes tough, and there are no easy answers out there. There are absolutely no easy answers. The third thing is that when we have to power large engines, and now there are large engines coming from large distributors, from the manufacturers, from the exchanges, our own large engines that we've created, consumers looking for an instant gratification, which means that he gives an instruction and he needs a confirmation very quickly, which means the way we serve information and the way we serve disparate units of information which were stored differently and treated differently earlier, all of that has to be brought together almost synchronously in one place and just shipped back so that the guy can see a concluded transaction, because that is what he's expecting to do. Now that redefines completely the way data is architected and data travels, and the way we package it and serve it back to him. That becomes very important. And the fourth thing is that around this whole concept of security and privacy, I think for a long time, all of us have believed, not just in mutual funds, but in the financial sector, saying that as many copies of the data that we create, as much redundancy as we create, and as much real time we get into backing up our own operations, that is the way to nirvana. Now that is half the answer, but the full answer is certainly not that. and to make sure that through excess redundancy, we're not adding layers of cost and completely superfluous operations that we will end up doing, saying you had two data centers, you move it to three, and then you have other backups somewhere else, and you try to do all of that in real time. It needs just optimization of solutions in this entire framework of managing data traffic, which is almost real time. So that is the way I would think about it, how to deal with the consumer through UI, UX, and making sure that access is simpler, and he continues comparing us with consumer internet, doesn't give up on how we treat him in terms of accessing and using the properties, the way we architect data and traffic, the way we think about security, and the way we think about talent. I would kind of list those are the key axes on which we are planning the future.
I was given that there are other RTAs. This question is very pertinent for all of you. How are you thinking about your with the advent of digital, your role and your service models in the future?
Yeah. So I think my take, Mayank, in this is that if we're fairly unique in this market, given that we do RTA ourselves, I think the RTA models will change. Right, because of digital, because of technologies, I think Anuj talked about. I will not be surprised that digitalization is almost 85-90% in the next 4-5 years. And if you use technology like blockchain, I think that benefit will come to support the scale. The great part in India is the way we are growing. All this would not mean that you are reducing some stuff. Maybe you become more efficient as you take on the growth. But I see it, obviously, with Franklin Templeton. We are not hesitant to say the way we started 10 years back, we are not like that from an RTA perspective. The teams are different. The roles are different. You will see less and less of people who are just processing stuff. You will see people doing different stuff. When the client, I think, going to go to Alexa and say, I want to buy a mutual fund, that ability has to be there with somebody like us to say, how do you service that? So I'm betting that the model will look very different in next 5 years on RTA side than what it is today, because the client needs will change, we'll become more efficient. I think from a distributor side also, I would assume the regulator and distributor and manufacturer will come together and they'll play a larger role as well, like what I see outside happening. You know, there are models like omnibus model outside, where distributor, because they're regulated, they are given much more authority to deal with the client. So put all that together, I don't see the model will remain the same. It will significantly change, and you know, some of that benefit will get transferred.
So my last question to the panelists, and I'll go with all of you on this. As rightly pointed out, if we look at the process of digitization, that is at a fairly advanced stage, but the amount of digital business that is coming is still at a fairly nascent stage in the industry. To accelerate the digital transformation, what support can the entire ecosystem, whether it is the distributors, whether it is the banks, whether it is the regulators, government, where all can we benefit from support from all these ecosystem stakeholders? And maybe I'll start with you, Ramesh.
I think currently these kind of things are happening. A lot of distributors are definitely taking on to digitization. The exchange platforms, a lot of people are using, MFU they are using. They are directly using many of the AMC's website, CAMS Carvey website also people are using. So digitization, people have taken over. But the point is, to what extent it has really entered into the blood of the distributors is a little bit of question mark, because the kind of products that we have, there are many special products, different kind of products, different needs. Those kind of things have not come into digital as much. For example, a children growth fund is there. There are some insurance related funds. All those kind of different kind of specialized products, which is specific to AMCs, those things have not come in digital. A pure play purchase redemption switch SAP STP, I think many people have already taken on into getting into digitization. Even at rural places, if you see people are getting into this because of the convenience. I would think that in another 3 years, you will come to a stage where digital electronic transaction submission will be to extent of at least about 75-80%. Because it's fast growing, people have started getting used to transacting it. As Nirav said, the mobile is so easy. So like that, transaction also is going to be easy. It is becoming easy. I think in another 2-3 years, we'll see about 70-75% transaction coming on this one. Many of the distributors I know who have now got into MFU or other digitized means like stock exchange or other things have stopped keeping forms in the office at all. That's a good sign. Even in places like Indore and Jaipur and other places, they don't keep any forms at all. So I think it's a matter of time when the digital transaction increases to a large extent.
Ganesh, your views on what ecosystem support you would benefit from?
Yeah, so I would break that into three pieces. The first thing is we need to understand what we mean by digital. If digital is all about digitization, then we need the help of the regulators to make the whole process paperless. Even if the regulator helps us with a paperless process, but we know that mutual fund is extremely underpenetrated in India at less than 2-digit levels versus the overall household in this country. And we want to be in tier 2, tier 3, tier 4 towns, which would be the next aspiration. I still feel there would be a lot of still physical form that would come in terms of running the process and expanding the size of the industry from 7.5 crore folios to 15 crore folios to 20 crore folios. If you take the banking industry, for example, I think this industry is still about 3 decades old. If you take the banking industry, it's about 100-year-old industry, and we still see, as I said, between 157 crore and 5 crore is the difference. And I can't think of any bank which has not invested heavily either in mobile platforms or in web applications, etc. But the adoption has been very low. So I don't think it's going to be an easy path, and I don't think we should force ourselves into the path just because, you know, digital is a great thing. My sense about digital is it is nothing to do with IT. My sense about digital is how you want to redefine the paradigm of doing business. If we are able to establish that, for example, if an investor gets easy access, simplified access to what products to choose, from where to choose, how much, depending on his longevity, risk profile, etc., it starts with that. Those kind of products being available across the counter on a internet application, and then the ability to transact, to me, that's the last leg of the story in terms of his ability to transact, because after his ability to transact, as I started, the rest is already digital. The rest is completely digital. The statements, the portfolio, the valuations, the cost of investments, your XIRR, your long-term capital gains, your short-term capital gains, your dividend income, you name it, your holdings across portfolios. Maybe serviced by Carvey, maybe serviced by Templeton, maybe serviced by CAMS, across. It's all available on a digital format. So I would like to say that a little bit of regulatory support to make it paperless, although I don't know how much success it will have when you are going to tier 3 and tier 4, and the fact that if we attribute digital to digitization, there could be a tremendous amount of success that we could achieve.
I just want to make a slightly different point, but it'll converge at somewhere at your question. For a period of time when I joined this industry, I believe that in this entire mutual fund food chain, the RTAs are at the end of the food chain, which means they receive a lot of stuff, and then they have to innately develop the capability to deal with disparate pieces of information, formats, protocols coming to them, and sometimes you just take it as a feature of your business. But I'll give you a contrary example, and this is something that we've implemented over the last 6 months and has been successful. We are now processing transmissions, which means if an investor passes away, we are processing transmissions in 5 days, which means that his family or his successor or the second holder gets the units in 5 days. I can challenge you that banks don't do it, life insurance companies don't do it, and we believe we could not do it till we thought that we are the center of the universe and we could influence with our constituent manufacturers, a uniform process of acceptance and a uniform process of processing and a single helpline, and we made that happen. So I also believe that a lot of this kind of service innovation, we're not in the arena of product innovation, but service innovation will ride first principles, clean sheet of paper, simple aggregation and non-cluttering of processes the way they're executed today. If the investor is willing to take the first step of making electronic submissions, then I think a lot of this stuff will be possible. It's an on-ground example. I'm not talking of strategy, but I can tell you it's life-changing for a lot of our investors who say you've treated us better than our bank has done or the insurance company has done. And that's a first for the mutual fund sector. So things like that are possible. I think we're continuing to imagine that service innovations with digital can far outreach our capability in terms of how we define it today, and therefore that will be one way to transform the industry.
One quick point I just want to mention that in the case of the mutual fund industry, particularly in the Indian context, I think more than looking at benchmarks elsewhere, we have to kind of disrupt ourselves. For example, for onboarding a customer in the MF industry, we do T+1. I can't think of a single bank which gets a physical paper with proof of identity and proof of address running a process which will make sure that the customer account is set up in one day. There's no chance unless he comes through fully online with some limitations and so on. You talk about redemptions. I think we are the only industry which runs payouts in T+1 for liquid. And we are the only industry which runs redemption. Of course, T+2 payouts happens in the stock exchange as well. So there is a comparison there. We are the only industry which aggregates data, as I said, across portfolios. We are the only industry which runs most of the processes on T+1 because they're not because of anything that great that we are doing, but because the industry demands are so, because the NAV has to be announced the next day. So we need to really disrupt ourselves and still figure out how we can become a Book My Show versus a Swiggy to take on to the next level.
So quickly, I think a couple of points in those segments. From a regulator perspective, three things come to my mind. One is, I think we should be willing to undo some stuff in case, you know, that belonged to the past and not really to the digital. Second is, I think we should think pure play digital sometime. Sometime the view saying this is a paper process and let's digitalize it doesn't work. You have to think digital and it may not be same. And third thing is that I think we should try to learn from outside. There are enough and more examples outside India for this. On distribution side, my only request would be to co-opt. I think become part of the journey for your client, put the client center, and you will find a lot of that thing coming from the client. I think from all of us, RTA and the manufacturer perspective, we should be able to provide customized segmented solutions to our distributors and clients. Because everybody is not same, and you can't say, okay, I have a website which works for everybody, or I have a platform which works for everybody. We should be able to provide those customized solutions to these people, and they can pick and choose. This works for my model, I'll take that. That does not work for me, I'll not take it. So I think those kind of things will help.
So fair bit of takeaways. We are running out of time. Can we have a round of applause for the very interesting insights by all the panelists? Maybe we have time for one or two questions from the audience, if there's any.
Okay. Yes, good afternoon. My question is to all the three RTAs that we have received a message regarding the KYC compliant, that the clients who have not been KYC compliant, the brokerage would be stopped. And we have applied to CAMS Carvi for details regarding the clients who are not KYC compliant. And still, till now, we have not received any mail back report from CAMS or Carvi. So what is the status regarding that?
Thanks for raising this. We can take this on the sidelines. So feel free to grab me when I come off the dais. But there's a ready, just to answer you. No. I'm not skipping the answer. I just want to keep it short. That there is a ready mail back report with no delimitation of time. We've readied that. I can give you the number and you can start accessing it today. I'm sure Carvey would have done something similar. So that would be available.
Why brokerage is not being paid?
Okay, is your question that a mailback is not available, or is why brokerage is not being paid?
We have received that the mailback report is there, but I have tried to download the report. The report says no data. I have just received the mailback from L&T also right now. I have tried to download it, but it says there is no data available.
I'll get you help with that. I'll get you help with that. But was your question this, or was your question why brokerage is stopped?
Both. After that, once the report is done, we do all the KYC of the customer.
Right.
Then by when or what time our brokerage would be released?
Once you remediate, it is in the hands of the AMCs to take a decision as to whether it will follow in the next month's cycle or it will follow with a lag of time. That is the conversation best to be had with the mutual fund that you're talking about. On the mailback, on the information, we will help with you. And if there's some piece not working, I will help you with making sure it works for you.
Okay, thank you very much.
There's one more question that side.
Everyone is talking about the digitalization, and everyone is saying the time should be reduced for the transaction and everything. Today, as like not only me, most of the distributor are facing issue in the AIF account opening form, which is duly signed required by the clients. So my only question is that when we are working on a digitalization and we have a KYC signed duly with every access with the every registrar, so why the AIF is required and getting the time increase for the account activation for the distributors in a physical mode of holding?
Are you saying that you have to go to different registrar for KYC, or what is the question?
No, my question is that today if anyone places an order through BSC platform, people are asking for the AIF, account opening form duly signed by the client. Today when we were talking, we have to reduce the time. Today, and the reason is being given to us that there is a signature which is required to be verified. When today a person is having a duly signed KYC and he's KYC verified, why we cannot remove that and increase the ease of the person to open an account within a minute?
Yeah, correct. So good point. I think that's the point we also discussed in the forum, that how is it that we can make the complete KYC process fully electronic. Today, when you do the eKYC process through the OTP process, there are limits on 50,000 and so on. But if you do eKYC through biometric and maybe at a later stage retina, you know, your question will get resolved automatically with unlimited investment. But for that, the process has to move to a biometric because there are regulatory interventions there. Yeah?
No, so my question was, today, even if I'm KYC verified and I'm opting for the MFD option, like in a BSC platform, I'm just giving an example, a client has to sign an AIF form, account opening form duly signed. My concern is that if client is already a KYC verified and he has given you all the documentation, then why the signature is required? Because today as an AMC, you are already having his signature, his documentation. He's only using a platform for the execution.
I think these are related to the exchanges. If we can take this question offline, because nobody is representing the exchange here. So this question specifically that you're asking, I would suggest that we take that offline and find some solution for you. Yeah?
Okay, thank you.
So there's a last, in the interest of time, we'll have to take
a last question. Yeah. Question to MFU. Reliance Mutual Fund ne last 3 months se SIP Insure launch kiya hua hai. Lekin aapke platform mein aaj bhi SIP Insure nahin hota hai.
Oh, development ho chuka hai. We are just waiting for the RTA connectivity for it. I think in another 3-4 days it should be, it should most probably be launched.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. We will have the next session soon. Now, thank you.
Thank you very much, sir.